हेलो फ्रेंड्स, हियर आई एम प्रेजेंटिंग यू चैप्टर नंबर 19 ऑफ मार्केटिंग मैनेजमेंट, इंट्रोड्यूसिंग न्यू मार्केट ऑफरिंग्स. इन दिस चैप्टर वी विल अंडरस्टैंड टू थिंग्स, द चैलेंजेस विच द कंपनीज आर फेसिंग व्हेन दे आर इंट्रोड्यूसिंग द न्यू प्रोडक्ट टू द मार्केट, एंड द सेकेंड इज न्यू प्रोडक्ट डेवलपमेंट प्रोसेस विच इज ऑल्सो रिफर्ड एज NPD प्रोसेस. सो इन द बिगिनिंग ऑफ द चैप्टर वी हैव हियर द एग्जाम्पल ऑफ गोदरेज छोटू कूल मिनी रेफ्रिजरेटर. नाउ फ्रेंड्स, दिस एग्जाम्पल शोज दैट how Godrej was successful in introducing an innovative or new product to the rural market. So the adoption and use of refrigerators in rural and semi-urban India generally suffers because of the unavailability of the power supply and low affordability. So to overcome this barrier and to provide some sort of benefit of refrigeration to the rural customers, Godrej developed an innovative solution in the form of mini refrigerator, which is referred as the Chotu Kool. So this particular mini refrigerator, the price was 35% lower as compared to the lowest price conventional refrigerators available into the market. The weight of this mini refrigerator was only 8 kg, so it was very easy to move from one place to another. It was portable. It works on the cooling chip and a small fan that consumes only 55 watts of power, so the power consumption was also less, and it is also designed to operate on dual power supply including the batteries. Further, this particular mini refrigerator was available with different storage capacities of 30 liters and 40 liters, the size which was appropriate for the consumers from the lower income strata, because these consumers do not purchase or store the large quantities of food and other products. So that is why was also the reason that why they designed the product in this particular size. So this way Godrej coordinated with the other NGOs working with the rural women, then they worked with the self-help groups, they worked with the microfinance organizations to enable women to sell this particular product, and in return they gave the commission on the basis of the sales, and this way the women were also able to add their income in the entire household. So this way Godrej Chotu Kool was an innovative product that provided the benefit of refrigeration at a lower price to its customers, particularly in the rural areas, and it was quite successful into the market. So let us understand new product options, like what are the different options the company is having for developing the new product. So there are variety of types of new products and the ways to create them. The first is to make or buy. Now company can add new products through acquisition or through development. So talking about acquisition, so when acquiring, the company can purchase other companies, that is one particular company can buy other company, which is referred as acquisition. The company can buy the patent from the other companies, or a license or the franchisee from another company. So this is one method of developing the new product, and the companies which are operating into various sectors like pharmaceutical or FMCG or food and beverages or IT services, these companies are growing into the international market by acquiring the companies into different countries. So this is one way of introducing the new product into a different country. But if the company wants to grow in a very proper manner, in a very organic way, then in that situation the company needs to develop the new product from within the organization. So there are a lot of companies which are introducing the or developing the new product within their own organization without doing any sort of acquisition, but for that the company requires a lot of resources. And if the company is establishing new product within their own firm, then they can protect their market share, and they can also do the expansion into different countries also. The second option is what are the different types of new products. Now generally there are two meanings of a new product. New product can range from new to the world product to some sort of improvement which is done into the existing one. So talking about new to the world products, so the products which are completely new to the world, which has not yet been created by any other company and which leads to the development of the totally new market, that is referred as a new to the world product. Like say for example, the first company which came up with दिस आईपॉड वॉज एप्पल. सो एप्पल इंट्रोड्यूस्ड दिस आईपॉड विच इज़ द एग्जाम्पल ऑफ कम्प्लीटली न्यू टू द वर्ल्ड वेर इन देर वेर नो अदर प्लेयर्स इन टू द मार्केट इन टू आईपॉड एंड इट लेड टू द न्यू मार्केट फॉर आईपॉड इंडस्ट्री. सो दिस वे द कंपनी कैन एस्टैब्लिश टोटली न्यू प्रोडक्ट टू द वर्ल्ड. एंड द सेकेंड ऑप्शन इज द कंपनी कैन डू सम सॉर्ट ऑफ इम्प्रूवमेंट्स और रिविजन्स इन टू द एग्जिस्टिंग प्रोडक्ट. लाइक इफ द कंपनी इज कमिंग अप विद डिफरेंट flavors or with different models, then that can also be referred as a new product. But the companies which are coming with a totally new product, these kind of companies are less than 10% because it requires great cost and even more risk. But the companies which are introducing totally new product to the world, if they succeed, they can definitely create a greater sustainable competitive advantage than ordinary products and produce significant financial rewards also. So talking about the second point, minor improvements or revision of the existing product. So this way here you can see the example of Colgate, that Colgate has come up by adding different ingredients. It has come up with different paste which is referred as Colgate Pain Out. So when the company is coming up with different flavors by adding different types of ingredients, or the company is doing some sort of minor changes into the existing product, then that can also be referred as the new product. The company Colgate, talking about this Colgate Palmolive in India, that it has different variants of Colgate toothpaste brand, Colgate toothbrush, Colgate mouthwash and different oral hygiene products. So this way the company can go for brand extension and into different category it can come up with into different types of products. So this is another way of establishing a new product into the market.
In this slide we have the challenges in NPD, that is new product development. The first point is innovation is essential or innovation is necessary. So today we are living in a very competitive era. Today the economy is rapidly changing. So that is one of the reasons that why continuous innovation is necessary for most of the companies. Apart from that, highly innovative firms are able to identify the new ideas very quickly and they try to grab the market opportunity. These companies are having a positive attitude towards innovation. They are risk takers and they adopt new technology, and with the help of a good teamwork they are able to generate or develop the new product and launch it into the market. So innovation is all about creating the new choices. It's about the generation of new ideas and working on it or implementing that. But it's not necessary that whenever a company is launching a new product it will always be a success only. It is an experiment, so success and failure, both the things are possible. So some of the companies, they fail for a new product for many reasons. Like the company might not have done the R&D or market research properly, or the estimation of market size would be more, or the cost of development of the new product would be very high, which the company may not be able to afford it. Or I can say that poor designing is possible, or if the product is proper, then the company might not have positioned it properly. So incorrect positioning can be one of the reason of the failure. The company may not pay that much attention on advertising and marketing efforts, or the price may be high, or the distribution support may not be proper. It is also possible that the competitors are very strong and they are fighting very well, and because of which the new product may not be able to survive into the market for a longer period of time. The company may not be able to generate the return on investment. So these can be the different reasons for that why the new product may not be successful. Apart from this, some of the other reasons for new product failure are as follows. The first one is a shortage of ideas. So in some of the product categories, it is very difficult to identify or to generate new ideas. Like say for example, if I talk about in the category of steel or detergents, or in the market of tea, coffee or cement industries, in these industries it is very difficult to have innovative ideas. So because of that, the company cannot launch an innovative or new product in these categories. The second reason is smaller market segment. Now generally whenever the company is launching any new product, the companies must aim their new product at a smaller market segment. So if the market segment is small, obviously it will lead to lower sales and profits for each product, and because of this the company may not be able to generate enough profit and revenue. Then the another reason is cost of development. Now, whenever a company wants to develop any new product, then first of all, it must generate many ideas. And for all these things, the company requires a high R&D cost, and apart from research and development, the cost of producing or the cost of manufacturing, the cost of advertising, marketing. So these costs are also associated for developing the new product. Now, then the next reason is capital shortage. Now, there are few companies which may have good ideas, but if they have good ideas and if they have the shortage of capital, then again it may not be able to develop the new product. So some companies have good ideas, but they cannot raise the funds for research and development and for even launching and producing the new product, because they are having the shortage of the capital. The other reason for the new product failure is development time. Now, generally, it requires a longer period of time for developing a new product. So, generally, the companies must try to reduce this development time, because if the company is taking a long time for developing a new product, then in that situation, many times the competitor may come up with a better product and grab the market share. The other next reason is poor launch timing. Now, if the company is launching a product before the competitors, the company may have a first mover advantage. But many times it may happen that the competitor is launching a product more or less similar to that one, and it is grabbing the market share. And meanwhile, when the other company is coming up with a similar product, then it might be possible that there would be insufficient interest into the target market. So it is very important to identify the right time for launching the new products, so whether they want to launch before the competitors or they want to see the competitor launching the product and they want to come up with a better product. But again, they need to do the R&D to identify that when they will launch after the competitor, whether the sufficient number of buyers would be interested into purchasing that product or not. Then the other reason for failure is shorter PLC, which refers to product life cycle. Now, these days, because of the development of technology, it is very easy for the rival firms or the competitors to copy a successful product. So whenever a company is launching any product and if it is successful, generally what the competitors do, they copy and they come up with a similar product. So, and if the price is a bit less or if the competitor is providing a better product, then all the customers move from that company to the competitor. So this leads to the shortening of the product life cycle, and if the product life cycle is short, then definitely the company will not be able to generate the sufficient revenue as per the expectation. The last one is organizational support. Many times the company is having a good idea, it wants to launch a good new product, but the new product may not be getting that much support which is required in terms of financial help or other management help which is required for the development of that new product. So this was all about the different reasons which leads to the new product failure. Although the company may fail for the first time, but it may still continue with the same idea with some sort of improvement. So initial failure is not always the end of the road for an idea. So the company may always learn from its mistake and continue, which may always lead to the development of the new product in future. So the next we have the new product development decision process, which is also referred as NPD process. NPD stands for new product development, and this process is also referred as stage gate process. So this is the most important part of the chapter. So here you can see in the diagram that the entire process of new product development, that is the innovation process, is divided into 8 different stages. Stage 1 is idea generation. Stage 2 is idea screening. Stage 3 is concept development and testing. Stage 4 is marketing strategy and development. Stage 5 is business analysis. Stage 6, product development. Stage 7, market testing. And stage number 8 is commercialization. So these are the 8 different stages which are involved in the new product development process. And if the company is not getting enough inputs at every stage, you can see an arrow which is written no. So if the company doesn't get the required inputs at every stage, then it can drop that particular stage. So this we'll understand step by step in detail. And when the company is doing this kind of new product development process, so it requires a strong market research study of consumers' needs and their wants, their interests, the company must also do a strong competitive analysis, and the knowledge of the technology must also be there. So only then the company can do this NPD process in a very proper manner. So let us understand this each and every stage in detail.
Stage number one, idea generation. So the new product development process starts with the search for the new ideas. The new product ideas can come from various groups or by using various creativity techniques through which the company can generate various ideas. So here we can identify that how the various ideas can be generated. The first point says that interacting with customers. Now company can do the research, and with the help of the research the company can ask the customers that what kind of product they would love to have in future. So customers can be the source of generating the ideas. Then employees can be a source for ideas for improving the production products or services. The company can motivate its employees to submit the new ideas, and the company can also come with some sort of reward system that the employees who will submit the best idea, they will be rewarded with some sort of incentive, maybe monetary or non-monetary. Then the company can take the ideas from the technical people like engineers. The company can also generate the ideas from the channel members like retailers, wholesalers, agents, brokers, because these are the people who are aware about the market and they know about the needs and wants of the customers. Then top management can be another major source of ideas. Apart from that, the company can also find good ideas by researching the products and services of the competitors and even other companies. So this way they can find out that what the customers like and dislike about the competitor's product, and they can even buy sometimes the competitor's products, and through that they can do the SWOT analysis and come up with new sort of ideas. Apart from this, the company can also generate the new ideas from the advertising agencies, from the market research firms, from the industrial publications, from the consultants. So these can be the various sources from where some creative ideas can be generated. Then the second point says that product needs can be explored through one-on-one interviews and focus group discussions. So the company can generate the idea by having a one-to-one discussion, maybe with the channel members or the employees or the customers. Or the company can go for focus group discussion, wherein the company can invite 6 to 10 people, allow them for discussion, and try to generate the ideas from the discussion which goes on among the members who are invited. Then under that we have crowdsourcing. Now crowdsourcing refers to obtaining ideas by soliciting contributions from a large group of people, especially from an online community. So crowdsourcing means inviting the internet community to help to create the content or the software. So it is one type of taking the involvement of the people for designing the product, and they can also offer some sort of prize money or form of incentive to the customers if they are giving some good idea or giving some sort of good design to the software or the content. So this way these are the various methods that how the company can generate the new ideas. So in the continuation of the same, here are the seven ways to draw the new ideas from the customer. The first one is observe how customers are using the product. So here the salespeople and the researchers can regularly observe that how the customers are using the product, how they are disposing, what type of products they are purchasing, whether they are purchasing the competitive products or not, then what is the decision making process, what attributes they are looking for when they are purchasing any kind of product. So this will give them some sort of insight which will help to generate some sort of idea for the development of the new product. The next is asking the customers about the problems with the product. So here the salesperson and even the market researchers can ask the customer that what are the products they are currently using and what kind of problems they are facing, so that whenever the company is coming up with a new product, then they can overcome all those problems. So this will help them for doing some sort of modification in the existing product. The next is asking the customers about their dream products. So here the company can ask the customer that what kind of product they are dreaming for in future, or what kind of product they would be love to use in the future period of time. So here the customers may give their feedback. Whatever ideas or whatever dream products the customers are giving, it may be feasible and it may sound sometimes impossible also, but yes, it can be one way of generating the idea. then use feedback of customers on the websites for new ideas. So here the companies can take the help of a search engine optimization, or the company can have a different section of taking the feedback from the customers, or the company can get some sort of advice from the existing customer. So this will be helpful for doing some sort of modification in the existing one. The company can use a brand community to discuss the product. So here the company can invite the brand users, those who are currently using the company's product, and with the help of the discussion the company can generate some sort of ideas, and from that the company can identify that what sort of improvement or what sort of product they should come up in the future. The next is encourage the customers to share new ideas. So the company can definitely ask the customers and encourage them with the help of some sort of incentives, or with some sort of, you can say, innovative techniques wherein they are sharing some sort of insights, probably for the completely new product or doing some sort of modification in the existing one. Creative techniques also can be used to generate the new ideas. So some of the creative techniques have been listed here. Is the first one is attribute listing. Now under attribute listing, the company can ask the customers to list the various types of attributes or the characteristics or the features which the customer is looking for into a particular product. So whatever attributes are listed by the customers, that will give an idea to the company that what are the features or the characteristics which the customers are looking for in a particular product category. The next is mind map. Now under mind mapping, the company can give some sort of thought to the customer. Like say for instance, the customer is given to think on a car, for purchasing a car. Then the customer can be given a piece of paper and asked to write down whatever comes into his mind for purchasing car. So here the customer will think of various brands. So suppose the customer may think that it is Mercedes, or the so whatever comes into the customer's mind, he is supposed to write that on a piece of paper. So the customer may write the name of the brand, the customer may write that it should be made in Japan or made in Germany, and all the different associations which comes into the mind of the customers pertaining to car, that should be written into the paper, onto the paper. So this way the entire new idea will materialize, and even it will let the company know that what are the different things which revolve around the mind of the customer when he thinks of a car. So this will give the idea for the company to develop or to build a new type of car. Then the other creative technique which is used is lateral marketing. Now lateral marketing is nothing but it combines the two product concepts or ideas to create a new offering. Like say for example, now talking about laptop. So laptop, it is a combination of laptop and tablet. Talking about gas station stores, which can be a combination of gas station, at the same time it can have a food store also in the same premises. The other idea which has been combined is like Kinder Joy, which is a combination of a chocolate or a candy and toy. So this way the company can combine two products and serve to the customer. So this way also the new ideas can be generated. Stage number 2 is idea screening. Now at this particular stage, the main purpose of the organization is to drop the poor idea. Now at stage number 1, the company has generated a majority of the ideas by using different techniques and different methods as we have discussed. So it is not possible to move ahead with all the ideas. So here the main purpose of the company is to drop all ideas which are not feasible enough to take it ahead. So in screening the ideas, the company must generally avoid two types of errors. The first one is drop error and second one is go error. Drop error refers to dismissing of a good idea, and go error it refers to the concept when poor idea moves into the development. So both the ideas, both the errors must be generally avoided. Many times if the idea is good but still it is dismissed because all the members into the committee, they may not agree or they may criticize a good idea, maybe because the cost may be too much, or they are pessimistic in nature, or they might have that perception that this kind of idea was adopted in the past and it was not successful, or they may feel that this is not the right time, or they say that it can't be done, or we have tried it before. So this can be the different you can say views of different people, and because of which a good idea may be dismissed. and the second one is go error, where the poor idea may be taken ahead and which may result into the failure into the future period of time. Now there are three types of product marketing failures: absolute product failure, partial product failure, and relative product failure. Generally, when the company is not selecting a good idea, then in that kind of situation it might be possible that absolute product failure may take place. So it refers to the loss of money, as the sales do not cover fixed and variable costs. So when there is a total loss of money because the company is not able to cover neither the fixed cost nor the variable cost, that is referred as absolute product failure. The second one is partial product failure. In this situation, the sales cover all its variable cost and some of its fixed cost, but still the company is not able to generate the revenue as per the expectation. So in this kind of situation, the product may survive but for a shorter period of time, and it's not able to generate the revenue as per the expectations of the company. The third one is a relative product failure, which refers to the concept when the company is able to generate a profit lower than the company's target. So here the company is able to generate the revenue but not as per the you can say the standards which are set. Then the company should also estimate the product's overall probability of the success. Now when the company is selecting or screening some of the good ideas, then those good ideas must be described in detail. So the description must include the product idea, the target market, the competition. It should also include the roughly estimated market size, the product price, development time, cost, manufacturing cost. So this kind of rough idea must be there. The executive committee then reviews each idea against a certain set of criteria which are set. Like they may have different criteria, like does the product meet the need or not, would it offer superior value to the customers, will it be able to distinguish itself from the competitors, or can it be advertised properly, or is the company having sufficient capital and know-how for the development of that product, will that product able to achieve the expected sales volume or growth or profit revenue. So this kind of you can say different criteria can be set to identify that whatever idea the company has selected, whether it can go ahead or not. So the company can check the overall probability of success by multiplying the probability of technical completion into probability of commercialization given the technical completion into the probability of economic success given the commercialization. So this way the company can assign the percentage of all the three probabilities, and whatever the score comes, the company must judge whether that probability is high enough to continue the development process or not. Also, the company can use a different, you can say, weighted index method, which is also referred as product idea rating device, wherein the product success requirements can be identified by having different criteria, like whether the product is superior or not, what is the performance to cost ratio, then whether the competition is high or not. So this way the company can assign the different weights to different parameters. The on the basis of the identified parameters, the company can give the scores to all these criteria, and the company can identify the product rating by multiplying the weight into the product score, and whatever the total comes from that, the company can identify that what is the probability of success of that particular product idea, taking it to the next step. So this is all about idea screening. Stage number 3 is concept development and testing. Now the ideas which are attractive and good enough, they must be further refined, and they should be converted into product concepts, and each product concept must be tested further. So here we have two terminologies: product idea and product concept. A product idea is a possible product which the company might offer to the entire market, and product concept is nothing but it is an elaborated version of the idea which is expressed in consumer terms. So product idea can be converted into a product concept by giving the answer to the following questions: that who are the users, what is the benefit of the product, when and how it can be used. So this will lead to the category concept. So this concept I'll explain you with the help of example. Like say for instance, a large food processing company is having an idea to come up with a powder which can be added to the milk to increase its nutrition nutritional value and taste. So this is just a product idea which has come into the mind of a company which is into food processing. So this is a product idea, but the consumers don't buy the product ideas, but they buy the product concept. So let us understand that what is a product concept over here. So a product idea can be it can be turned into various concepts by asking several questions, as I said. So the question can be, who will use this product? The powder can be focused or targeted at infants or to the children or to the teenagers or to the young and middle-aged adults or to the older adults. So these are the different possible you can say alternatives that who can be the target market. The second is, what primary benefit should this product provide? So they're talking about this nutritional powder, the different benefits which it can provide to the consumers can be taste or nutrition, refreshment, energy. Then the third is, when will people consume this particular drink? So what can be the options of preferring or consuming this drink, which can be, it can be taken in the morning, during breakfast, or during lunch, during afternoon or dinner or late evening. So these are the different options about the when the product should be consumed. So by answering these particular questions, the company can form different category concepts. So here the first concept is, it can be taken as an instant breakfast drink for adults who want a quick nutrition. The second concept can be, or the second possible option can be, it can be a tasty snack for children to drink for refreshment during the daytime. And the third possible concept or option can be, it can be a health supplement for the older adults to drink in the late evening before they go to bed, or probably after dinner. So these are the different category concept, and each concept is having a different set of competitors. Like suppose if it is taken for instant breakfast drink, so it would compete with cornflakes or hot milk or toast, bread, biscuit, butter, or upma, idli, whatever the people are taking for this breakfast. If it is a tasty snack, then the set of competitors would be soft drinks, fruit juices, sports drinks, and other juices. Fine. So this way, when the company is thinking of different category concepts, it helps to identify that who would be the different set of competitors for their probable product. Then after that, the company should move ahead. Like if the company has once decided that which category concept they want to take, whether they want to go for instant breakfast or tasty snack, or for health supplement, then the company should go for formulation of perceptual maps. So perceptual maps are a way to display the consumer's perceptions and preferences in a very visual manner. So here the company can go for product positioning map and brand positioning map, through which the company can identify that what is the preference into the mind of the customer, or what is the perception into the mind of the customers, by taking into consideration various products and various brands. So this way the company will be able to identify that what is the strength and weakness of various brands, that is various products into the market, and with the help of which it can get further ideas to do some sort of changes into its own product. So this is about the concept development, and next we have the concept testing. It means presenting the product concept physically or symbolically to target customers and get their reaction. So basically here the company is trying to come up with a prototype which it can show to the customers and measure their reactions. Concept testing of prototypes can help avoid costly mistakes, but it may be especially very challenging when the product is totally new to the world. So here the company can go for the adoption of rapid prototyping, wherein the company can design the products with the help of a computer, with the help of different images and different technologies, and the company can produce the rough models of each to show to the potential customers for their reaction. So here the company is not making the actual product, but the company is making the you can say virtual prototype with the help of computers, with the help of 3D images, and presenting this to the customer. So concept testing presents consumers with an elaborated version of the concept. So here, taking the same example, the company can come up with the concept testing by showing and explaining to the customer that their product is a powdered mixture which, when added to a milk to make an instant breakfast, which gives to a particular person the required nutrition along with the good taste and high convenience. The company can also further explain that it comes into three different flavors like chocolate or strawberry, vanilla, and the company can explain the various sizes. So say for instance, the company is coming with different sizes of 50 gram, 250 gram, and 500 gram, where the prices are rupees 50, 250, and 400 respectively, and the company can show them virtually the product prototype with the help of computer and 3D visual images. And after providing this kind of information, the researchers must measure the response of the respondents of the few selected consumers who are representing the entire population by asking the following questions. So the first question can be communicability and believability. So here the company is asking that whatever benefits they have explained to the customers, whether it is clear to you, whether it is believable to you or not, and the scores of all this response is measured. If the score of this particular question is low, then it means that the concept must be refined or revised. It means that the customers are not clear and they are not able to believe whatever the company is telling them. So the score should be measured. The second is need level. So here the question can be that, do you see this product solving your particular problem or not? So if the need is stronger, then it shows that this particular product will be successful and the customers will show a high interest when it will be launched into the market. Then the third question can be related to the gap level, which asks is that do other products currently meet this need and satisfy you or not? So indirectly is also asking that is there any other competitor into the market pertaining to this particular product category or not. The greater the gap, the higher the expected consumer interest and higher the probability of being successful of this particular product. Then the next question can be related to the perceived value, where the question can be, is the price reasonable in relationship to the value or not? So here the customer's perception about the price can be asked. The higher the perceived value, the higher is the expected consumer interest. The next question can be related to purchase intention, and the customers can be asked the question that, would you purchase the product or not on a Likert scale, by giving the different options like definitely, probably, probably not, or definitely not. Customers who answered the first three questions positively should answer definitely here, and if the customers are saying definitely not, that means they are not ready to purchase this product and they are not convinced. So the scores will give an idea about the success ratio of that particular product. Then the next could be about the user targets, purchase occasions, and purchasing frequency. So here the company can identify that who would use the product, when and how often, that whether they will be purchasing during the occasions or they'll be using frequently or regularly. So this kind of questions can be asked over here. Then the company can do conjoint analysis to find the utility value. Conjoint analysis is a statistical technique used in market research to determine how people value different attributes or like features or functions or benefits that make up an individual product or service. So the companies measure consumer preferences for alternative product concepts with conjoint analysis. So conjoint analysis is one of the most popular concept development and testing tool. So here the customers are presented with the hypothetical offers or the products having various levels of different attributes, and they are supposed to rank it between 0 to 1. So here you can see the utility function based on conjoint analysis. So here the marketer has used a statistical program to derive the consumer's utility function for 5 different attributes. So here the customer is presented 5 different attributes with package design, brand name, retail price, good housekeeping seal, and money back guarantee. And the customers are supposed to do the rating between 0 to one. For these different you can say attributes, utility ranges between 0 and 1. The higher the utility, the stronger the consumer's preferences for that level of the attribute. So looking at the first graph, here the customer is presented with three different package options, package A, B and C, and it is clear that package B is given the highest utility value of 1.0. So it is clear that the preference for package B is highest, followed with package C and then package A. The second one, with the brand name, the customers are given three options of brand name. The first one is K2R, then Glory and Bissell, and the highest score is given to Bissell, followed with Glory and K2R. So this way we can say that the Bissell is the most preferred brand name for the customers. Then for retail price, in terms of price, there is an inverse relationship, because generally the customers prefer the price wherein it's less, not the higher price. So here you can see that the highest utility value is to the price of $1.19, then $1.39 and then $1.59. So in price there is inverse relationship. Then talking about the good housekeeping sales, so customers have given the preference of yes, so high score is given to yes. So it means that good housekeeping seal is preferred by the customers. And money back guarantee, yes is the you can say answer which is given by the majority of the customers. So with the help of this kind of conjoint analysis, the company can identify the preferences of the customers by giving the options of various attributes, and they can identify that what is the preference of the customer. So this way concept testing can be done with the help of conjoint analysis. Stage number 4 is marketing strategy development. So after the successful concept testing, the new product manager will develop a preliminary 3-part strategy plan for introducing the new product into the market. So these three strategies could be, the first one can be target market size, sales, market share and profit for new year. So here at stage number 1, the company will identify that who would be the target market, what is the size of the target market, then what is their behavior, then how much would be the market share into the market for initial 1-3 years. So initially the company may have the goal of having 10% of the market share, and the company may not be able to achieve that much of profit, and it might be possible that the company may undergo loss also initially because of the increase in the advertising expenses. Then the company may have the goal of increasing the market share for the second year, which may be 15, and then subsequently it can increase the market share, and the company may also identify that what would be the profit for next 1-3 years. The company can also plan for the product positioning, that how it wants to position its product into the mind of the customer, whether it wants to position as a higher price and higher quality, or affordable price and high quality, or as a lower price. So this way the company needs to do the planning of all these things at the first part. The second, in the second part, the company may outline that what would be the planned price, what would be the distribution strategy, and what would be the promotion marketing budget for the particularly by taking the first year into consideration. So the company may need to identify that what would be the pricing depending on the different sizes, who would be the channel members, how much would be their promotional budget for the first year, how much discount or allowances they would be giving to the channel members, whether they will be giving any kind of coupons for the price reduction, if yes then how much. So these things should be identified at this second stage, and how much would be their advertising expenditure for the first year. The third stage of marketing strategy will include the long run sales and profit goals, and also the marketing mix strategy over a certain period of time. So here the company takes long term into consideration, which may be 5 years or more than that. So the company may have the goal of increasing the market share to 25%, and eventually it may increase over a period of time, and the company should also decide that what would be its profit goals after 5 years and 6th and 7th year eventually. And the marketing mix strategy, talking about the product price, promotion and play. So these things needs to be identified at the marketing strategy development stage. The next stage is stage number 5, business analysis. Now, after the management has developed the product concept and marketing strategy, it can evaluate the business attractiveness. So here the management needs to prepare the sales, cost and profit projections to determine whether they can satisfy the company's objectives or not. By identifying this sales, cost, profit projections, if it feels that it can satisfy the goals of the company, then the concept can move ahead with the development stage. And if it does not satisfy the objectives of the company, or if it does not meet with the goals of the company, then it can undergo revision. So here under business analysis, the company needs to do the estimation of total sales, estimation of cost and profit, and break-even analysis. So talking about the first one, estimating total sales. So total estimated sales are the sum of estimated first time sales, replacement sales and repeat sales, and it may also vary depending on the nature of the product. Like say for example, if it is a consumer durable product, then replacement sales can be identified, but if it is a perishable product or if it is FMCG product, then replacement sales may not be there. So depending on the nature of the product, the total sales must be estimated. And for different types of products, business cycle or the product cycle can be different. Then later on, the company should go for the estimation of cost and profit. So here the cost can be estimated by R&D, by manufacturing, marketing and finance departments. Here the company can prepare a cash flow statement and do the projection of 5 years by doing the analysis of sales revenue, cost of goods sold, then gross margin, the cost of development, marketing cost, then gross contribution. This way the company can prepare a cash flow statement and do the projection of next 5 years. So this method can be used for estimating the cost and profit. And later on, the company can go for doing the break-even analysis, which will help to identify that after how much period of time the company may be able to reach at the level of break-even. If the management believes that sales could easily reach the break-even number, then it is likely to move the project into the product development stage. So this way the company should do the business analysis. These three graphs represent the product life cycle sales for three types of products. So this is applicable when the company is doing the sales estimation. So sales estimation method depends on whether the product is purchased once, or it is purchased infrequently, or it is purchased frequently. So here you can see in the first graph, when the product is one time purchased product, like a purchase of a retirement home or a luxurious bungalow, or purchasing of engagement ring, which is purchased once in a lifetime, you can see from the graph that initially when the customers are purchasing the product, slowly and gradually the sales increases at the beginning, then it reaches at the peak level, and slowly and gradually it declines as the number of potential buyers are decreased. But suppose if still the new buyers keep entering into the market, then the curve will not go down, instead it will remain stable. Talking about the infrequently purchased product like automobiles or consumer durable products or some of the industrial equipments, here there is some sort of replacement cycle. So here the company must estimate that what is the replacement sales, after how much period of time the customers are replacing those products, and or the company should identify that what is the lifespan of those durable products. So this way the company can do the changes in the styles, features and performance, and the company can do the sales forecast of different product categories, and the company should identify the first time sales and the replacement sales separately for infrequently purchased products. Talking about the third one, that is frequently purchased product, particularly the consumer FMCG products, then here the you can see in the graph that when the product is introduced into the market, then the customers are purchasing slowly and gradually, the sales declines, and if the product satisfies few customers, then those customers are repetitively purchasing the same product in future period of time. So this way for loyal customer, the repeat purchase sales takes place. So for frequently purchased product, the company should identify that the number of customers are purchasing initially, which is referred as the number of first time buyers, and then the company should try to find out the repeat buyers as well. A high rate of repeat purchase means that the customers are satisfied and the sales are likely to stay high even after all the first time purchase has taken place. The seller should also note the percentage of repeat purchase in each repeat purchase class. That means the seller must note that how many customers have repurchased once, or whether they are repurchasing twice, thrice. So this way the company should find out the percentage of repeat purchases. Stage number 6 is product development. Up till this particular stage, the product has existed only in the form of word description or a visual picture or a prototype, but not the actual product. So here the company will determine whether the product idea can be translated into a technically and commercially feasible product or not. So here the company is using the method which is known as QFD, that is quality function deployment. Under this particular methodology, the firm takes the list of desired customer attributes, which is referred as CAs, which is generated by market research firms, and these customer attributes or CAs are passed on to the team of the engineers or the manufacturing people. So the major contribution of this quality function deployment is to transfer the communication from the market to the engineers or the manufacturing people or who are into the production department. Developing and manufacturing a successful prototype could take weeks or even years, but today, because of the development of the technology, rapid prototyping can be done in a shorter period of time. After the prototypes or the samples have been developed, then the company must go for customer testing. There are two types of testing: alpha testing and beta testing. Alpha testing refers to the test which is done of the product within the firm to see that how it performs under various situations, and after alpha testing the company also goes for beta testing. Beta testing refers to the test which is done among the customers. Now in beta testing there are different tools or techniques can be used: rank order method, paired comparison method, and monadic ranking method. Under the rank order method, the customers are asked to rank the different items in the order of preference. So suppose the customer is presented with three different options A, B, and C, and they are asked to give the rank of different items or brands. If the customer is giving higher rank to that company's brand, it means that particular product is successful, or it is having a positive review among the customers, or it satisfies the needs of the customer. The second one is paired comparison method. The paired comparison method calls for presenting the pairs of items and asking the customer that which one is preferred in each pair. Like here the customer will be given the option of A or B or B or C or C or A. So this way the company can identify that among the two presented items or brands, which one is highly preferred. And the third one is monadic ranking method. So the monadic ranking method asks the consumers to rate the liking of each product on a scale. So 7-point scale can be used, where 1 can be used for intense dislike and 7 for like, and 4 can be neutral or indifferent. So here the customer is supposed to rate a particular item or the brand on a scale of 1 to 7. Suppose if the customer gives rank 1, then it's a signifies that the customer has intense dislike for that particular product or the brand. And suppose if he gives the rating of 7, then it means that the liking is very high. So this way the testing can be done and the customer's preferences can be identified. After that, the R&D department must also decide how the consumers will react to different colors, sizes, and weights. So the these variations must also be shown to the customers during the testing. And if it is successful, after that only the full-fledged market testing can be done. So here under product development, the prototype is developed and customer testing at a lower level is done, or the respondents are lesser in size. And if it is successful, only then it will move ahead with the next step. Stage number 7 is market testing. Now after the management is satisfied with the functional and psychological performance, the product is now to be branded with a name, logo, packaging, so that it can go enter into the market for further testing at a large scale. Now not all the companies undertake market testing. Now suppose if the company is developing a new product which is completely new to the world, in that situation the company may go for market testing. But suppose if the company is coming up with some sort of variation or some sort of changes in the ingredient, and the company is quite confident that it would be successful, in that kind of situation the company may ignore the test. Many companies, however, believe that market testing can provide the valuable information about the buyers, about the dealers, about the effectiveness of the marketing activities and marketing potential. But still, the main issues are that how much investment should be done, then how the market testing should be done, which city should be selected, what should be the timing. So these are the issues which the companies are facing when they are going for the market testing. Then we have consumer goods market testing. Now, consumer products test, they seek to estimate the four different variables: the trial, the first repeat, adoption and purchase frequency. So here the company needs to identify, particularly in FMCG goods, that what is the rate of first trial. So generally when the product is distributed in the form of free samples, and the trial rate is high, but after the trial rate, the first repeat and adoption purchase frequency decreases. It may not be the case every time, but it may happen. Then after trial, what is the percentage of the people who are going for first repeat? After that, after the first repeat, how many number of customers adopt it and use it frequently? And then the purchase frequency, wherein the company needs to identify that what is the frequency of purchase, whether it is high or low. Many times the customer adopt it permanently, but the purchase frequency is less. So the company needs to identify all these variables, which will give an idea that if the trial rate is high and the first repeat is less, then might be possible that some of the attributes are not appropriate or the customer needs are not satisfied. So this way the company can identify the gap into the product. And we have four different methods of testing. The first one is sales wave research, then simulated test marketing, control test marketing and test market. So these are the different methods which are used for our testing. The first one is sales wave research. Here the consumers who initially try the product at no cost, that is in free, they are re-offered it, or they are re-offered the competitor's product at a slightly reduced price. So this way the offer is made as many as 5 times. So that is why the name is sales wave. And here the company notes that how many customers are selecting it again, and the reported level of satisfaction. So this way, by offering the company's or the competitor's brand several times, the company can identify that whether the customers are preferring the competitor's brand or their own brand. So this way the sales wave research can be implemented quickly. It can be conducted with fair amount of privacy and security, and without final packaging and advertising. So this method can be effective. But yes, when this brand is actually commercialized into the market, through this method the company cannot identify the brand's power to gain the actual distribution and favorable shelf position. So that can be identified only when the company is actually launched into the market. Then the next method is simulated test marketing. So here 30 to 40 qualified shoppers, they are invited, and they are asked about the brand familiarity and preferences in a specific product category. So 30 to 40 customers who are representing the entire population, they are invited to a particular store, and their preferences about a particular product category are asked. And after that, they are shown a brief screening of both well-known brands and even the new products. So they are shown the TV commercial advertisements or print ads of the well-known brands as well as the new brand. And after showing the advertisements of both the products or brands, the consumers are provided with small amount of paper money, and they are invited to a store where they are given the option to buy all the items. Then the company notes that how many consumers are buying the new brand and how many of them are buying the competing brand. So this provides a measure that whether the ad is relatively effective or not, which type of products are preferred by the customers, whether they are preferring the new brand or they are preferring the competitive brands. And after the purchase is made, which is not a real purchase but it is a simulated purchase, so consumers are asked the reasons that why did they purchase the competing brands, or why did they purchase their company's brand, and the reason that why did not they purchase the other brand. So this way a small interview is taken of the consumers where the reasons for purchase or non-purchase are asked. Then those who did not buy the new brand, they are provided with the free samples, and after some weeks or after certain period of time, these customers are interviewed by phone to determine or their views are taken about the product attitude, their usage, whether those products were satisfying their needs or not, whether they are satisfied or not, what is their repurchase intention. And this way they are offered an opportunity to repurchase the same products in a future period of time. So this method can give some accurate results on the advertising effectiveness, on the trial rate, on the attributes, whether the customers are satisfied or not. And even this method takes a shorter period of time for testing. The next test is control test marketing. Here the company with the new product specifies the number of stores and the geographic location where it wants to do the test. In this method, the research firm delivers the product to the selected panel of participating stores and controls the shelf position and pricing, display and point of purchase promotion. Then the electronic scanners are used to measure the sales which are done into that particular store. After a certain period of time, the company is evaluating the impact of local advertising with the help of that store and the promotions, and the interview of the customers who have purchased the products from that particular store is done. So this way the company can identify that which type of products have been preferred by the customers, what is the reason. So this way their views can be identified by doing the interviews of those sample of customers. But the main disadvantage of control test marketing is it exposes the product and its features to the competitors also. So that is the biggest limitation of control test marketing. Then the next method of testing is test marketing. The ultimate way to test a new consumer product is to put it into a full-blown test market. So here the company chooses a few representative cities and puts on a full marketing communication campaign and tries to sell the product into the selected city and measures the response of the customers. The cost of full scale test is generally higher, but it again depends on the number of test cities, the test duration, the amount of data they want to collect. So under test market, the company needs to take several decisions, particularly five different decisions. The first one is how many test cities. So majority of the times most companies test for 2 to 6 cities. Then which cities. So selection criteria generally includes the good media coverage, the cooperative chain store, and the competitive activities which are done into the stores. So generally the company is selecting those cities which are representative of the entire nation. Then the third one is the length of the test. So what would be the duration of the test, whether it would be few months or year or weeks, that needs to be decided. Then what information to collect. So here the company needs to decide that after the testing is done, then what kind of information they'll be collecting through the intermediaries or through the in-depth information or the interview which is taken by the consumer. So the buyer surveys generally yield the in-depth information about the consumer attitude, usage, satisfaction. So this information is collected. And the fifth decision which the company needs to take is what action to take. So if the test marketing is done and if the test market shows high trial and high repurchase rate, then the marketer should launch the product nationally across the nation. If a higher trial rate and low repurchase rate, then the company should redesign or drop the product. And the third situation can be there can be a low trial rate and high repurchase rate, then the company should try to develop marketing communication to convince more people, because the majority of the people are not aware about the new product. And if the trial and repurchase rates both are low, then the company should abandon the product. So this way the company can do the testing and identify that whether to commercialize the product into the entire market or not. So the next is commercialization, the last stage of new product development process. The commercialization incurs the company's highest cost. So here the company will need to identify that whether it wants to do the full-scale manufacturing on its own or it will give on contract. So the firm needs to do the full-scale manufacturing at this stage of commercialization. Now when the company is going for commercialization, it needs to take the following decision on the timing, where, that is a geographical strategy, then who would be the target market, and what introductory market strategy it would be adopting. Talking about the timing, the company is having the three choices: first entry, parallel entry and late entry. Now first entry, here the first firm entering a market usually has a first mover advantage, wherein it can lock up the key intermediaries, the distributors and other channel members, and the customers and the company can have leadership if the product is quite successful. But if the product is not satisfying the needs and wants of the customer, then the company may undergo loss as well. The second one is parallel entry. The firm might time its entry along with the competitors' entry. So here the both the companies are entering and advertising the new product at the same period of time. So here the customers will purchase those products which are better in their need satisfaction. So here it would be a tough competition for both the firms which are doing the parallel entry. Then the third one is late entry. Many times it's the company goes for wait and watch strategy. the firm might delay its launch until the competitor has borne the cost of educating the market, and when the competitor has done the advertising, it has created the awareness, and it has launched its product, then the company can identify the weakness of the competitor and can come up with a better product. And many times the late entrance is also having the advantage of increasing the market share. The next one is geographical strategy. Here the company needs to identify that when the company will go for the full-fledged launching or commercialization, then which type of geographical strategy it will adopt, whether it will roll out in the entire market simultaneously, or it will enter first go for the local market and then it will move to the other cities and other states. So when the company is identifying the geographic strategy, the major criteria can be the market potential, the company's local reputation, then the cost of communication media, then the type of people or the behavior of the customers, the needs and wants of the customers, the number of competitors. So with the help of all these factors, the company can identify that in which cities or in which towns it wants to enter, whether they want to do the entry slowly and gradually, or they want to enter the entire region or the entire nation at the same point of time. Then the next one is target market strategy. Here the company needs to identify that who would be their target market, whether they would be early adopters or heavy users or the opinion leaders. And the last one is introductory market strategy. So because the company, when it is going for commercialization, it has to do a number of activities, so to coordinate the many tasks in launching a new product, the management can use the network planning technique, which is referred as CPS, that is critical path scheduling, which develops a master chart showing the different simultaneous and sequential activities that takes place. So when the company is going for commercialization, it is doing different set of activities, like it is going for advertising, promotion, then distribution activities, advertising. So this way, through this critical path scheduling method, they can develop the different types of activities which the company is undertaking and how much time it requires for the completion of each activity, and the goal should be to reduce the this much time taken by each activity. So that the company needs to identify under the introductory market strategy. So here we complete the entire NPD process. Here you can see in the process that at every stage, if the company is not successful, then it will drop that particular stage. Talking about market testing, if the company is successful, it will move ahead with the stage of commercialization. If the company fails in market testing, or if it gets negative results, then it will go back to product development, send the idea back for the product development, and again go for the market testing. Similarly, if the company gets positive results in the commercialization, then it will go for laying future expansion plans. And if the company is not successful in commercialization, then it will modify the product or marketing program and again go for the commercialization. But if it is still not successful, then it will drop it. So this way the entire NPD process gets completed. So this is how the company must take different steps for developing a new product into the market. So here we complete the chapter. Thank you.